What if I told you that there are 9 secret tricks inside of Lightroom that the professionals use all the time? But for some reason, almost no one ever talks about it. Well, I've been editing photos for over a decade, and even I didn't know some of these until embarrassingly late. And once I did, my editing skills completely changed. And yours will too. So let's start with trick number 1. I would say the first trick is actually a 2-in-1 tip. You understand what I mean in a second. Let's say that we were to create a mask just around the tree branches and the vegetation in this photo. Now, the way we would do that is that you click the mask and you go to landscape and you click vegetation and create mask. Now you made a mask that hits just the tree branches. Now, this is really good, but this is not the trick that I'm going to show you because it's not that perfect. If you zoom in, and here you can see the problem that when you do this, there's a lot of bleeding happening within this mask. You can see that, especially if I take up the exposure, that it bleeds a ton because it's really hard creating masks just around the tree branches. Imagine doing this just with the brush. But my friend, there is a fix to this. So let me show you what I mean. Because if you take this mask, you go to click it, minus, and you subtract the sky mask from this vegetation mask, take a look what happens now. Boom. With just one click, this mask became 1,000 times better. This is with after and this is before. You see the difference? It's huge with just a few clicks. And keep in mind, my friend, that no matter what mask that you're working with, you can subtract from it anything that you want or even add to this mask anything that you want to further help customize this mask. It's so good and it gets me really excited. All right, tip number 2. This, my friends, is an absolute game changer. I learned this just earlier this year, which is just super embarrassing that I didn't know this. But once I did, my jaw just dropped. And I think your jaw will also drop. Or at least your brain will melt a little bit. Because if you click the masking here, you go to plus, and we create radial gradient filter. Now you can create a circle. I'm just kidding. This is not the cool part. This is a little editing joke for editors, you know, for us nerds. But what I'm going to show you with this circle is that let's say that I want to make the circle a little bit bigger in this direction and I do it like this. The problem is when you do that is that when you stretch it in one direction, it also stretches in the other direction as well. And maybe in some situation, you don't want that. You just want to expand it in one direction. My friend, you can actually do that. If you hold in Alt on your keyboard like this, and then you drag one corner, you can see that you're just expanding one corner. this is just so good. I saw it and I kid you not, my brain melted and I was like, why did I not know this? And look, I'm just expanding one section and the other section here, it stays completely still. Fantastic. By the way, I made a free 33-day email series, one short tip a day to help you become a better photo editor. It's totally free and you can find it in the description down below. All right, so tip number 3. Now, while we're talking about these types of masks, then let me show you one thing that is really good to know. You go up here, click mask, and then you click plus, and you go to linear gradient filter. And the problem with a linear gradient filter is that it moves quite a lot. And if you want to create a like perfect horizontal thing, it can be a little bit tedious to do. And as you can see, it's always a little something going like this. This wiggles a lot. It's a wiggling mask. Aaron, this is not a good joke. But anyway, what you can do to get a perfect mask is to go to linear gradient filter. And if you hold in shift while you're doing it, it becomes straight. I know. This is just so good. And it works from any way. Even if you want to have it in this direction, you can up, down, like this. And as you can see, it's just totally straight and evened out and makes life much simpler and more enjoyable. Spend less time trying to make it balanced, you know? This is a little trick I often use to help make my sunset colors or sunset photos pop a little bit more. Now, one thing to keep in mind when it comes to photo editing is that you have a lot of weapons in your arsenal and many of them do very similar things. In my opinion, you just have to pick and figure out what works best in any situation. And you can also stack them together to get a more unique look and also just more control. And here is one of the things that I like to do. So to make the sunset colors pop a little bit more and give it more oomph to my photos, you can click masks up here, go to plus, and then you can click color range. Now you get this little pen tool, and wherever you click on your photo, you're going to create a mask around that color. So we're working with sunset color. We click the sunset colors right here. And as you can see, we get a mask that is just affecting the color. You can see up here, color orange. So, so, so good. And you also have this slider, refine slider. So now you can take it and you can refine this mask. And now, with this mask selected, you can go down to the temperature slider and you can take it up to get more oomph to your photos or to the sunset colors. And you can also, of course, go to saturation and take that up as well. Now, this is obviously too much. I'm just showing you for the sake of the tutorial, so you understand. But play a little bit around with this. See how far you can drag these sliders. You also have the tint sliders and, of course, the basic corrections here as well, if you want to. Tip number five. What I'm about to show you now is something that completely changed my edits and allowed me to create much more three-dimensional photos and add much more depth to my images. And let me show you what I mean. So, for instance, this photo right here, you can see that I have a ton of masks. And the aim with them is to shape the light and help make a more three-dimensional look. For instance, this is with the mask on and this is with the mask off. This photo is pretty decent, but it lacks a ton of depth, which when I have the mask on, it creates. You can see, after, like, no mask, mask on. What I'm going to show you right now is this mask up here. This is what I call side light, all right? So what this basically is, it's a mask, a radial filter that I keep up in the corner, the same corner as the light source is coming from, and then I take down the dehaze and clarity to help emphasize on this light. So the light is coming from this direction here, up here, and I'm just placing it up here in the corner. I can show you it better on this photo right here. So here I have the mask, and here you can see this is with all the mask on, this is with the mask off. Mask on, mask off, mask on. Isn't that some like rap song? But anyway, let me just show you from the beginning what happens. We create a radial gradient filter, we place it up in the corner, just like so. Remember, the same corner as the light source is coming from. And then you have the feather. I usually like to feather mine out quite a lot when I do this. So somewhere around here, maybe. And you can play with the size too and everything that you want. Maybe you want to press Alt on your keyboard to just move it down in this direction because you're a freaking ninja. And then what you do is that you take down the dehaze and the clarity. This just to show you again. I wouldn't do it this much, but these are the main sliders in this effect. You can also play around with exposure. I would be a little bit cautious with the exposure and whites. Just do them ever so slightly if you want to increase the light source there. But one slider that is good to keep in mind too is the temperature slider. Because we're emulating the sunlight, you can take the temperature slider and move that up to get more warmth into it. You understand? But also do this a little bit sparingly, and I wouldn't do this to any photo. Just you have to, with your own critical eye, take a look at the photo and be like, does it work if I have more warmth to my side light here? But my friend, this is a side light and it's sick. All right, tip number six, and this, my friends, is to separate the boys from men and the girls from women. Probably not, but I don't think small children are editing, but you know what I'm trying to say here. Basically, what I want to show you here is the art of stacking masks together to get more control. So, for instance, with the side light that I just showed you on this image, you can see clearly what happens up here. I actually have two masks that kind of do the same thing, but a little bit differently. For instance, we have this big mask up here that I just showed you in the previous tip, but above it, I have this mask. It is the same thing. We have down the clarity, and I'm helping, like, shaping the light, but I'm shaping it as a cone. And my idea here with the shape is to have this beam, which is beaming down into the fjord. I'm getting too excited talking about this. But I have it shaped like this to help beam this light down to the fjord. And in combination with this one, I think it creates this perfect combo. And you can see me do it on so many different photos. I have one photo here. And as you can see, the same thing. This is without mask and this is with mask. And I have this big filter right here, and then I have another one up here. Doing the same thing, but stacking them on top of each other. And this technique does not just apply, of course, to this light source mask that I showed you. It applies to anything in mask. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of life. It's a way of life, son. But basically, for instance, let's say that I want to darken the foreground. I can have a linear gradient filter like this, and I'm darkening the foreground ever so slightly. Then I can take another and have a brush tool, and it's doing the same thing, but a slightly different shape. I'm going a little bit up the edges, and here I'm taking down the exposure just tiny, tiny, tiny. Then I might decide, this is a little bit too much, so I'll take it down, and maybe this one I have very, very, very strong. And then another one, linear gradient, and make it much higher up, but much, much, much more subtle. Now I have a very strong vignette down here that subtly comes less and less and less. This is, of course, too much, and I'm just showing you this in the name of explanation. But you understand what I'm trying to say. Stacking masks on top of each other to get more control. By the way, if you want to skyrocket your editing game and learn how to turn your good photos into great ones in just 30 days, then check out my full Lightroom Masterclass. It's everything that I learned about photo editing, both for myself and professionally, put into one easy to follow along step-by-step course. Here's a photo a student sent me the other day. He was a total beginner when it came to photo editing, and you can see the before and after. There's a massive difference. Now, in this course, I, of course, share with you all of the techniques that I use to edit my photos, but I also want to go beyond just moving sliders and go into the theory and the reason behind the decisions on why I make certain choices. Plus, there's a full module on just color theory, which is well important if you want to take your editing game to new heights. Now, at the time of the recording, over 300 photographers are taking this course, and I can guarantee that it will massively increase your editing skills in just 30 days. If not, I will give you your money back. Yes, I am that confident. Anyway, I'll see you in the course. All right, so tip number 7, and this, my friend, is absolutely magical. I think I say that to everything, but I truly believe that everything inside of here is just magical. So what I'm going to show you here is how to make your photos much more dreamy by adding this dreamy glow effect, also known as the Ortolan effect or halation, film halation. Now, what you can do to make a photo more dreamy is, of course, to take down the clarity on the entire photo like this. You can see this is with the clarity up, more digitally sharpened, and this is with the clarity down. But the problem with taking down the clarity here is that you're softening the entire photo. What you can do is to just softening the highlights and then have a nice smooth roll off to the shadows. And this is where you emulate that film look. Now, personally, I like to have a combination of the clarity and this, but I'm going to show you what I mean here. So if you click the mask and you click plus, and now you go to luminance range, you get this pen tool, and basically it allows you to select just the highlights or the midtones or the shadows. So we are going to select the highlights, the brightest part of the image. So you just find the brightest parts here. And as you can see, you've made a mask around them. And here you have the luminance range. So up here, this is the brightest part. And down here is the shadows. And this here is the gradient tool. So for instance, let me just show you if you take it like this. Now we have the mask just selecting on the brightest areas of our photos. Now, personally, I like to have a nice roll off or a nice gradient down to the shadows. So I select just the highlights, and then we can roll it off somewhere around here. All right, up to you. You just have to figure out what your photo can do. Now, what you have to do is just to take down the clarity, and you can even take down the texture, and you can take down the dehaze just ever so slightly to create a little bloom effect like this. And boom, you've softened the highlights and creating a beautiful filmic glow. And again, a little combo, this, and then the overall clarity slider. Oh, baby, you've made some really good things. Tip number 8. This is also a hidden feature that many people don't know about, but it's so good. So let me show you this. You're working with the tone curve, and let me make a more extreme tone curve. So this is, but like you can see this better, all right? So something like this here. The problem with the tone curve is this is just so fantastic. It's one of the best tools like in Lightroom for sure, but what happens with tone curve is when you increase the exposure, the contrast like this, you also get a lot of color in the photos as well. You're increasing the saturation as well. So underneath here, this is a fairly new slider, like 1 or 2 years old, and it's called refine saturation. So basically, if you drag it down, you desaturate the photos. This is very, very subtle, but just take a look at the oranges here. Let me show if I can show it like this here. So we get like decent amount of saturation like this, and take a look at the oranges. Exactly down here, or the blue, so all the colors, take it down and it becomes more desaturated. And this is so good to know about, because if you want to have a very, very contrasty photo, but you don't want it to be all wacky with too much colors, you can take down and refine the saturation just ever too so slightly to your liking. Tip number 9. This is the foundation of colors in Lightroom. And I've noticed that many people, especially in the beginning, find this panel really, really intimidating. Intimidating. What am I doing? So all the way down here, you have the calibration, the color calibration sliders. And it allows you to shift the way Lightroom interprets the red primary color, green primary color, and the blue primary colors. Basically, this panel changes how your camera's colors are interpreted within the software by, as I just said, adjusting the base tone of red, greens, and blues before you start to edit them in the HDR sliders, all right? So what you can think about this is that calibration tool is the first layer. It shifts the way that Lightroom interprets these tones, and you get a base tone, and then you can take that base tone and get up to the HDR slider, which then is a layer that sits on top of that. You understand? And the way I use these, I have these different recipes that I think look pretty good. For landscape photos, I often like to take up red primary color to plus 20, blue primary down to minus 30, and then I'm playing around with the green primary colors as well, usually to the plus side. That gives a very nice look to the greens. But this is just the base, and then I go up to the HSL slider and start moving them around. But if I'm working with portraits, I have a different set that I like to do. Sometimes I have it like this. I know that I really much like to have minus 15, plus 45 here, and plus 25, and then I actually take minus. This is just something that I've come up with after doing this for so long, but minus here too to minus 14, and then plus with the saturation too. I think that this mix here gives a really pretty skin color, but again, this is just the start. After this, once you set the base tone, you go up to HSL slider and start to work on the colors a little bit more. However, most photo editors, they stop here, and that is actually a huge mistake, because if you truly want to level up your editing game, you need to learn how to use Lightroom properly from the start. And that's exactly what I break down in detail in this video right here.